First try.
First try.
That's awesome. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It's right to give our thanks and praise.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. And that is why we are here this morning. Welcome to St. James. We are a United Methodist congregation whose mission is to nurture the risen life of Christ in all people. And I'm so glad that you've chosen to be with us for worship on this Sunday morning. A couple quick announcements for us as we get started. You can see all of our important announcements on the back page of your bulletin today. And as always, you can see even more details about these things in our weekly newsletter that we send out. I just want to highlight a couple of them for you. First, a big celebration for Empty Bowls. We don't have final and exact numbers yet, but we know that between the meals, we were able to distribute out of the kitchen here for delivery and pickup on Thursday, well over 300 meals. Between the sales from that and our donations, we know we have raised well over $10,000 for our mission partners. We had a great team of all of you in church who have been a part of it, and our community members and Warren County School employees who were working so hard on Thursday and in the lead up to the event. It was a great success. So we have a big celebration for that. If you would like an Empty Bowls t-shirt for a recommended donation of $10 as we continue to raise money, here they are. These are the sizes laid out here, and so you are welcome to pick one of those up this morning. You can also see information about Light the Night, which has been known as Hall of Treats, which has been known as Trunk or Treat, our Halloween event, which is going to be October 24th from 4 to 6 p.m. Damara put some of these flyers at each of the main entrances to the church, and she encourages if you have a workplace or another place where you could hang one of these up about that event, please do so. Grab one and take it with you. This is a chance for us. We want to share the love of Jesus with our community in the form of candy and food. And there's no, you know, there may be no better way to do that. That's not necessarily scriptural, but we'll just run with it. So, share the word about that, and we'll be sharing more details about it as we get closer. Again, it is good to be with you for worship this morning. I invite you to stand and join with us in singing our opening song, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Moments and my days, let them flow.
Remain standing as Gwendolyn brings us our scripture reading, and continue standing for our song of response following.
Our reading today is from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. I'm reading from the Common English Bible.
That's not correct. Gwendolyn, we got the wrong paper for you, honey. Sorry about that. There you go. Verse, chapter 9, verses 1 through 10.
All right. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verses 1 through 10. This is too heavy now.
It's too heavy for your stand.
All right. So, I considered all this carefully, examining all of it. The righteous and the wise and their deeds are in God's hand, along with both love and hate. Sorry, I lost my spot. People don't know anything that's ahead of them. Everything is the same for everyone. The same fate awaits the righteous and the wicked, the good and the bad, the pure and the impure, those who sacrifice and those who don't sacrifice. The good person is like the wrongdoer. The same holds for those who make solemn pledges and those who are afraid to swear. This is the sad thing about all that happens under the sun. The same fate awaits everyone. Moreover, the human heart is full of evil. People's minds are full of madness while they are alive, and afterward they die. Whoever is among the living can be certain about this. A living dog is definitely better off than a dead lion, because the living know that they will all die. But the dead know nothing at all. There is no more reward for them. Even the memory of them is lost. Their love and their hate, as well as their zeal, are already long gone. They will never again have a stake in all that happens under the sun. Go, eat your food joyfully and drink your wine happily, because God has already accepted what you do. Let your garments always be white. Don't run short of oil for your head. Enjoy life with those who, with your dearly loved spouse, all the days of your pointless life that God gives you under the sun, all the days of your pointless life. Because that's the part you play in the life and your hard work under the sun. Whatever you are capable of doing, do with all your might, because there's no work, thought, knowledge, or wisdom in the grave, which is where you are headed. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Seated and pray with me. God, we thank you today for the reading and the hearing of your word. And I ask now that as I seek to proclaim it, that the words I speak would be yours and not my own, and that each of us would hear what it is you are saying to us this day, that we may come to know you more deeply and serve you more faithfully. Amen. Friends, I am excited today to begin a short series on the book of Ecclesiastes. As I said in Sunday school a few minutes ago, I get really excited to do series like these and talk about books like these because I get a lot of enjoyment out of talking about the books that I know other people try to avoid. And Ecclesiastes is one of those books that people try to avoid. And I joked even earlier at the gathering time that after you hear a passage like the one that Gwendolyn just read for us, it is a little difficult even to follow up that passage with the words, "Thanks be to God." But that's why we do it, right? It's why we do these things as Christians. It's why we do these things in our worship, because it's a discipline, it's a practice, it is a habit of thanksgiving and gratitude that we do no matter what. And this series is I'm really going to be leaning in a couple things. One, kind of overarching this whole conversation is going to be the core value that we have articulated as a congregation to celebrate in all things the goodness of God and His grace, right? Which is exemplified in the act of saying thanks be to God in response to a passage like what we just heard. That we celebrate God's grace and His goodness in all things, okay? And then we're also, each week, it's going to be 3 weeks here. We're going to do 2 weeks, and then I'm going to be on vacation, and Christian's going to be preaching for us, and then the third week after that. And in each of these weeks, we're also going to be looking at a holiday that's coming up that Ecclesiastes is able to speak into our practice of. While I was preparing for this series, I read in the commentary that I'm using something that I had not heard about wisdom literature before. And wisdom literature is a particular genre that we have in the Bible. And in the Old Testament, we have a couple examples of it in the New Testament as well. But in the Old Testament, Proverbs is the most famous example of wisdom literature. And then you have Ecclesiastes and the book of Job. So three books, three very different styles of books that are all considered wisdom literature. And my commentary said that wisdom literature back in those days when it was written was usually written for children who were receiving formal education, okay? For children who were being educated in the way to live and the right way to think and the right way to believe, and wisdom literature was written for them. And Proverbs is the best possible example of it, right? You have 31 chapters, but the whole book is just a collection of sayings, like one or two sentence sayings that tell us how we should live and the right way to do and the right way to be as people in this world. And what you have in Proverbs and what you have in traditional wisdom literature is this assumption of a straight line cause and effect between doing the right thing and having good results. Okay, the assumption that underlies Proverbs and the kind of wisdom literature that is written for children to have as they receive that formal education is that if you do good things, if you live the right way, if you do the right things, right, then there will be a straight line from those actions to good results in life. Things will work out for you. Things will be good. You will not have to worry about the things of this life. That is the assumption. And what the commentary says is that when you get to wisdom literature like Ecclesiastes, we're no longer dealing with wisdom literature that is for children. We're no longer dealing with wisdom literature that assumes a straight line causation from doing the right thing to having good results. Instead, wisdom literature like Ecclesiastes is, according to the commentary, written for teenagers. It's a little bit more grown up. It's a little bit more honest about the ways of the world. And it acknowledges that you can be here and you can be doing good things and you can be doing the right things and you can be living the right way, but what's ahead of you is still unclear. The result that will come from living the right way is still unclear in this life because it's not always fair. It's not always right. It doesn't always turn out good or well. And so it becomes a very difficult book to read. Because we are forced to confront some of the realities that all of us are a little bit more comfortable avoiding than talking about. In fact, it reminds me of one of my favorite pieces of imagery in the New Testament. Multiple times from multiple different authors in the New Testament, we as Christians are told that we have to move past the milk to the meat, right? That when we first come to know Jesus, when we first become people of faith and followers of Christ, we are infants in the faith and we are fed the milk of the Christian faith. Right? The milk of the Christian faith, the stuff that is easy to consume, the stuff that is easy to digest, the stuff that is easy to process and understand, that's the stuff that we get. when we are infants in the faith. And if we choose to, we can remain there for as long as we want. Right? We can remain there for as long as we want. We can take in John 3:16, and we can take in Psalm 23, and we can take in all these things that we know and we love, and we can sing, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, because he does, and it says that, and it's true, right? But we can stay there for as long as we want and just keep taking in the milk, but we will never become mature followers of Jesus Christ if we stay on the milk. At some point, the New Testament tells us, we have to move from the milk and we have to get to the meat. We have to get to the meat. We have to get to the stuff that has to be chewed on, that has to be worked through, that takes our body a little bit more time to digest and a little bit more work for us to process. That, the New Testament tells us, is how we become mature Christians, mature believers, mature followers of Jesus Christ. Ecclesiastes is not milk, it is meat. And we must chew on it and work through it and process it. And while we do that, as I said a moment ago, we're going to think about the way that Ecclesiastes informs some of our practices and informs some of our celebrations as Christians. Today, we're going to be talking about how it informs our practice of Halloween. Halloween. I'm a big fan of Halloween, personally. If I had the money to do it, I would have elaborate and expensive costumes every year. There's a show that we've been watching on TV the last few years, and one of the things the family in this show does is they go all out on like the matching coordinated outfits, like as expensive as they can buy and as good looking as they can buy, and they go all in. Like, that's exactly what I would do, and my children would have no choice but to participate. If they're going to get candy, they're participating. And, I mean, we would go all out. But don't have the money for that, so we just try to figure it out as best as we can. But I love Halloween. I love Halloween just for the fun that it is. I love Halloween for the enjoyment that it is. I love Halloween because it's literally the only night of the entire year, and it's just amazing that this even happens, when every door to the houses in your neighborhoods are just open for you to go and knock and get candy from them. Right? It's the only time in the year that everyone from your neighborhood is going to come across your door on the same night. Missionally, for me, that is just, wow. Right? Missionally, the idea that, you know, we have this one night of the year where everyone in our neighborhood, if our light is on, is going to come knock on our door. Every kid in our neighborhood, I have a chance to interact with them. I mean, yes, I love Halloween for a whole bunch of different reasons. And it is, but it's one of those holidays that has been somewhat controversial during this time. Some of you may have had this. Some of you may have had family members. Some of you may be families who aren't big fans of Halloween, right? You don't like to engage in it. You don't like to practice it. Or your parents didn't like to practice it, and it's not so much your favorite thing. Because, let's be honest, Halloween been a bit co-opted by the world, you know? A lot of pagan kind of ideas and practices go into it, and all the movies that we make about it and all the little things, you know, and then you see some of those kids who come to your door, they're dressed like, woof, some of the costumes that our kids are wearing, but that's all right. scares me a little bit, but I can get it. I can see why Halloween may be a bit of a controversial thing for some people. And so, as I like to do, I went and I looked a bit more into the history of Halloween. I assumed this would be the case, and I was right, that Halloween, in some version or another, goes back thousands of years. It, like many other holidays, had pagan origins. The earliest traces of what can now be identified as Halloween go back to the early centuries in A.D., the early A.D. centuries in the Celtic regions, Ireland, Scotland, those areas, where they practiced, it was for them kind of the end of their year. This was Halloween, harvest season, was the end of their calendar year. And so they had a lot of festivals and traditions that went along with that. And over the course of several centuries, as Christians came into the Celtic regions, as they converted those people to Christianity, as we often did in the church, we took a pagan festival and we added some stuff to it, we changed it around, and we made it Christian, okay? And so that's what we did around these things. We made it Christian, and eventually what we ended up with is this day for us, now the first Sunday in November, But right there around what was for these ancient peoples the beginning of the new year, what is called All Saints Day. All Saints Day, or All Hallows Day, which is, of course, preceded by All Hallows Eve, Halloween. And so we made it a thoroughly Christian celebration, a celebration that focused on remembering those who have died, celebrating their life which continues with Christ today, and also celebrating the fact that those of us who are still here are still alive. Praise the Lord. And so you have these celebrations and these festivals of Halloween, of All Hallows Eve, that are about that are celebrating, guys, we're here and we're alive and we can party and have fun because we're here. Praise the Lord. That's good stuff. And then the next day on All Saints Day, we remember those who have died and we celebrate that they have joined the great hall of witnesses that we read about in the New Testament. And not saints, I need to be clear, when we say All Saints Day, though, I'm sure y'all are aware of this because we practice it every year, All Saints Day, not in the sense of saints who have been venerated, but all the followers of Christ in the New Testament understanding of the saints, that we are all the saints. That's what we celebrate on Halloween and on All Saints Day, a thoroughly Christian holiday that we have somewhat lost, but is very much ours. It's a fun day. It really is. It's meant to be so. It's meant to be a celebratory day. You know, there's the expression that goes, death is the great equalizer. Right? You've heard that expression? Death is the great equalizer. And that's what our teacher in this passage is talking about, the teacher of Ecclesiastes. Be righteous, wicked, good, bad, pure, impure, sacrificial, greedy. We all die. That's the first of the three big themes of Ecclesiastes that we'll be exploring in this series, is that everyone will die. So how do we celebrate the goodness of God and His grace in the face of the reality that we will all die? Last week, during worship in the park, in the fellowship hall, I described the teacher of Ecclesiastes as depressed. He kind of feels like he's depressed, but I actually want to revise my thinking about that somewhat. I want to revise my opinion on that one, because as I've read it more and read about it more, I don't think he is. I think he just has a mature understanding of this concept that we learned a little bit about in our gathering time called hevel. Hevel. It's the word that in Ecclesiastes, in most of our translations, is translated as pointless or meaningless. The book is bookended by this statement that everything is meaningless or everything is pointless. In this passage today, a really great good news from the Bible for us today, your life is pointless. Thanks. Right? That's how this word hevel gets translated. But in reality, in our efforts to translate the book in as clear a way as possible, we have lost the meaning of this word. It often happens. Translation is an art, and it is a challenging one. It is not a science. Hevel most literally means smoke or vapor. I said to Gwendolyn on the way in, if you were happened to be in your car during like the 8 o'clock hour this morning, the fog was just gorgeous. And we were driving through the fog, and the sun was just beginning to cut through it. And so it was cool because we were going up Cumberland Trace, and we were like in the thick of the fog, and we couldn't see out in front of us, but we could still see shadows starting to come in from the sun, from the trees and things. It was gorgeous. It was beautiful. But it makes the road unclear. It covers up what's ahead of you. You don't know what's coming or how close it is. It's like being in the fog. That's what hevel really means, this Hebrew word that is translated as meaningless or pointless. The right way to translate would be to say everything is as smoke or everything is as vapor. It is temporary. It is ephemeral. It is impossible to grasp or hold on to. It will all pass away or fade away. And this is not a depressing perspective on life. This is a mature and fuller understanding of life. Friends, we have to acknowledge this is an obviously difficult time to be talking about the concept of death. In the course of this pandemic, last week we hit a grim benchmark. 1 out of 500 people in our country have died because of COVID. 1 out of every 35 of our oldest citizens, 85 years old and older, 1 out of every 35 have died because of COVID. But we have an interesting paradox when we go from the macro view to the micro view and look at our particular congregation, that all of us know people who have died, both from COVID and from other things. We always do. We always suffer from that. And I hope this remains the case, but as we come up on All Saints Day this year, as a congregation, no one among our church has died since last All Saints Day. Praise the Lord. It's a reality of life, but I feel like these two facts actually create a paradox that perfectly captures the teacher's point. That even in the face of incredible loss, even in the face of the loss that each of us have experienced, or people whom we love have experienced, or people whom we know have experienced, or just that the community as a whole has experienced, we still have among us in this local context, in this smaller context, a reason for celebration. And a reason for thanksgiving. And even if, as is normally the case, someone from our congregation had passed away over the last year, we would still be here. Those of us who are here are here. It is a reason to celebrate. Being alive is reason enough to celebrate the goodness of God and His grace. And while we wrestle with the paradox that the teacher has given us, the reality that we will all die and yet we must still enjoy our lives, I also think we need to challenge some of his conclusions. We need to challenge some of the conclusions that the teacher makes in this passage. In verse 10, he says, whatever you are capable of doing, do with all your might, because there is no work, thought, knowledge, or wisdom in the grave, which is where you are headed. And the Hebrew term he uses there for grave is the word sheol. Sheol, which is the Old Testament understanding of death. It is not heaven. It is not hell. It is not the resurrection. It is simply death. It is death. The end. It is silence. And this was the Israelite understanding of death in this post-exilic period, hundreds of years before Jesus Christ came. And the teacher of Ecclesiastes is limited both by that, both by the available understanding of the day, and also he is limited by the lack of Jesus Christ. Limited by the lack of Jesus Christ, his life, and what he did. Because we know, as Christians, Sheol, death, the grave, is not the end. There is rest in our death, but there is also the possibility that we can live again. And I believe that we can confidently, theologically, and appropriately say to the teacher of Ecclesiastes, you are right, we should celebrate that we are alive, and it is good to be alive, and we should rejoice in it, for these days are as hevel, and they will fade away, but that is not the end. We have the rest of the story. Your conclusion is not complete, because there is a risen life. So, we affirm what the teacher tells us, that it is better to live than to die. And we affirm that we should enjoy life in the present. And that's what we celebrate on Halloween. That's what it's actually about. It's not about the candy. It's not about the costumes or whatever else. But as Christians, as followers of Jesus, to take it back to the real meaning, it is a celebration of life itself. It is a celebration that once again, we are alive. But then on All Saints Day, we remember those who have passed and we celebrate their continued life. And we celebrate those who have gone before us. One day the time will come that we will die. This life for us will be over. The things of this day and the things of this life will be as hevel and will have faded away for us. But it is not true that we have no stake in what remains behind. It is not true that there is no thought, no wisdom in the grave, because it is not true that the grave is the end. When we die, we will, with all the saints, join the great cloud of witnesses, and we will celebrate the work that will be done, the kingdom work that will be done by the people in whom we have invested in our time on this earth, and the work that the people in whom they invest will be done after them. Yes, we will die, but that is not the end. And that's what we celebrate. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Having heard the word of God read and proclaimed, my friends, I remind you that Christ invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sins and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. We'll get that on the screen. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, in a moment of silent prayer, offer your personal prayers of confession to our God. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let's stand and celebrate that as we sing together the doxology. Be seated for our anthem. Christy's going to come forward and lead us in that. So, Christy, won't you come? Amen. Thank you, Christy, for sharing that with us this morning, for continuing in our worship. As we go now into our time of prayer requests and celebrations, I want to, again, celebrate Empty Bowl, celebrate the great work that was done this past week, and thank you to everyone who made that a success. I want to ask for a prayer request for Harold Sharber. I want to share this again, that he's continuing to recover from appears to be some inner ear injury he sustained in the accident that he had several weeks ago. So he's not going to be able to be with us in person for a few weeks as he's dealing with that. So feel free to reach out to him, share your love with him, and be praying for him as he heals from that. What are other prayer requests and celebrations this morning? So we want to continue to pray for Dorothy, your family, and family of Mark and Kelly Haynes, as Jackie Haynes passed away last week. Service was on Thursday, and family was together, and I pray that it was a beautiful time of remembering and celebration, as we've talked about this morning, and pray for your continued healing and peace. And praying for Amanda and Drew, been glad to hear. Drew's been doing better, and glad to have y'all with us this morning. Others? I'm sorry, Tamara, I didn't hear you.
And what was his name again? Rod. Tamara's friend Rod, who had an HLA, she had connected with his wife especially, and providing support and counsel to them through this experience, passed away yesterday. So we're praying for Rod's family.
And praying for you as well, as you continue that friendship and continue to share the love of Christ with them. Others. Luke Davis asked for prayers for a close friend's wife who's been diagnosed with breast cancer, and also for his boss. Yes, absolutely. We're praying. Thank you, Luke. Yes, Cindy. For misguided people. Pray for those who have misguided, that they may see the truth of Christ, the truth of situations, and let's always pray that we ourselves are not misguided. Yeah. Others. Yeah, celebrating. Good. Faith Goble is here with us. She's joining us. We are working on getting our bus up and running to do some weekly pickups. And Faith reached out to us, wanted to join us, and it's good to have you here with us. There you go. So you're all studied up. You're ready to go. Excellent. Thank you. Others. Okay. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's remember these. Let's take them before the Lord, and let's also remember to keep these before us throughout the week. As we have committed to one another as members of this congregation to be faithful in our prayers. So let us be faithful in our prayers to one another in the days ahead. Join with me. Lord, I'm struck as I begin this time of prayer, and as I continue in your presence along with my brothers and sisters this morning, I'm sometimes struck that I do not consider what we do in our prayer to be as great as it truly is. The idea that we can come before you in prayer and not just fall down in awe of you, as so many in Scripture did as they come into your true and real presence, it's just astounding, this gift that you've given us. Because, Lord, everything in this life is temporal, it is heaven. We feel that sometimes. We try to not think about it sometimes. We are confronted with moments where it's harder and more difficult, knowing that that's the case, than others. But you are not. You have always been, and you always will be. You created time itself. You are eternal. You are all-knowing. You are all-present. You are all-powerful, and you are in this place. You invite us to come before you in prayer. Here we are, Lord. Here we are. We are before you. We are here to receive your calling, your direction, all that you would tell us of how we might live and how we might serve you. Knowing that the answers may not always be clear, knowing that the path before us may not be straight, knowing that there may be things of this life that seek to get in the way, knowing that the enemy may move against us, knowing that the result in the temporary life of this earth may not be the good one or the best one or the one that we hope for, but keep before us, God, the eternal rewards of following you. The eternal rewards that nothing that is temporary can tarnish or take away. The eternal rewards of a risen life in your Son, Jesus Christ. Though that time of rest will come, we know that life will also come again. So this day we offer our prayers and our celebrations to you, knowing that you alone are the one who can hear them all, receive them all, and understand them all, because you are above all and in all. So we offer them to you today, and we pray, pour out your peace on us. Pour out your peace on us that we may have a fraction of your understanding. That we may know the hope of Jesus Christ in every circumstance. And that we may be people who are able to focus on the places and the situations and the people who you have put before us. That we may be people of healing for those who need it. That we may be people of comfort for those who need it. That we may be people of justice for those who need it. Lord, we are not adequate enough to know how and where to serve you, but by your guidance and by your presence and by following you, we may. So guide us this day. Guide us this day to those times and those places. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. And in the same way, we pray together the prayer that you taught your disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we prepare to come to the table, I remind you, as I look for my hymnal, there it is. I remind you and I celebrate with you the blessing that your gifts are to the kingdom of God, the faithful tithes and the offerings that you make every week or every month or however it is you do it, whether it's online or by mail or by dropping it off or here in person in one of our baskets today. You make God's kingdom work in this place possible. I think about empty bowls. I think about the fact that, you know, that is kind of a separate event. It's there's sponsors and there's money raised in the event. But if you didn't give, then our church wouldn't be able to function in the way that we do to support it and to make it happen. Empty bowls exist because Gary Taylor had the idea, and it exists because we had the infrastructure and the teams and the leadership to make it happen and to make it happen every single year. And what I love, one of the things that I love most about it is it doesn't matter who's standing here doing this part, that would still happen because you all have that leadership. You all have that commitment. You are faithful in your presence and in your gifts and in your service. And the way that you give every single week makes that possible. It equips it and empowers it. And that is the thing in my ministry that I get excited about the most, is the opportunity to empower followers of Jesus Christ to be faithful in their service and faithful in their gifts and their time, and to have the ability and the opportunities to do it. So however you give this morning, whether it's here in person or online, however you give all the time, thank you for those gifts. We celebrate them today. And it is in that spirit of celebration, it is in that spirit of celebration that we come to the table of our Lord Jesus Christ. We come to the table and we remember, as we have declared this morning, that it is right and it is a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, to give thanks to you. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with all your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he gave thanks to you. He took the bread. He broke it. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this as often as you receive it in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. And so it is in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, that we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As a reminder for you, as you prepare to receive your elements, this is not St. James's table. This is not a United Methodist table. So you do not have to be a member of this church. You do not have to be a United Methodist to receive this gift. This is the Lord's table. He is present at this place, and he has invited you to come and to receive his grace. And so, my friends, the body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Well, friends, we prepare to sing our closing song. It is an opportunity for celebration. It is an opportunity to celebrate in all things the goodness of God and his grace as we declare together, great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. Because, as we've said, there are many things in this life that fade away. There are many things in this life that pass away. Everything will. But in Jesus Christ, there is a risen life. There's a new heaven, and there's a new earth. And if you're with us this morning, and either in person or online, and you do not know Christ, you have not had that relationship with him, you have not had that opportunity to experience faith with him, I want to remind you today that that is the invitation that he has for you. He has the invitation to you that you may step beyond the understanding of this world, that all things will end and nothing goes beyond it. He has an invitation to you that you can move past that to a true faith and a true hope and a true experience of the risen life that only he can give. If that's you today, won't you say yes to his invitation? Let's stand and sing together.
Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true. By his
Amen. Friends, it has been so good to worship with you this morning, to enjoy the presence of Christ together. And we prepare to depart from this gathered experience of God's presence into the day-to-day, moment-after-moment experience of God's continual presence. So won't you go in the name of our Father in heaven, in the grace of His Son, Jesus Christ, and in the power of the Holy Spirit as a risen people who know that this life is not the end, and who declare the great hope of our faith, that we may and will live again. Share the peace with one another as you go. And go. Amen.